Hello children, welcome to class 9. Today, we are gonna learn our first prose topic of your textbook, Treasure Trove. I request all my dear students to open their textbook and mark the important points. Chapter 1, Chief Seattle's Speech. Let us begin with the introduction of Chief Seattle. Chief Seattle was born in the year 1786 and died in the year 1866. He was a public leader, the chief of the Native American, that is Red Indian, and he was the chief of Suquamish and the Duwamish tribes. The American city Seattle is named after him. He is specially known for his speech, or sometimes referred to as letter, delivered in the year 1854. This speech was a response to the American government's land treaty to buy the native land proposed by Isaac Stevens, the governor of Washington Territory. Chief Seattle's speech is regarded as the powerful plea for respect of Native American rights and environmental values. Seattle criticized the white people's imperialistic attitude and their way of reckless developments affecting the natural environment. In fact, this speech is considered as one of the earliest instances where someone expressed great concern over the degradation of nature and ecological balance. He warned the human being against the rapid progress of Western civilization and pitched for the need to protect nature. And this is why Chief Seattle's speech is acclaimed with such high esteem. Well, one important thing to know in the speech that Seattle delivered the speech in his native language, Lushootseed, Seed, and it has been translated and rewritten by several authors since then. So therefore, we don't know the authenticity of the available text is not confirmed. The oldest available record of this document is Henry A. Smith's transcript published in the Seattle Sunday Star in 1887. Let me tell you something about Dr. Henry A. Smith. So Dr. Henry A. Smith was a physician, poet, legislator, and early settler of Seattle, best known today for his flowery translation of a speech by Chief Seattle. Let us now ponder over the important purposes of Chief Seattle in his speech. Students, these are the important highlights to be remembered in this chapter. Here in this three slides, I have explained to you why Chief Seattle has written this speech. He has written the speech for some purposes, and they are being aligned in this slides. Now let us start with detailed explanation of Chief Seattle's speech. I have put up this complete Chief Seattle speech in the slides. This is the original transcription written by Dr. Henry, and now I'm gonna explain it in a easier manner, or you may also say that I'm going to give you a detailed summary of this chapter. So, at the very beginning of this chapter, or at the very beginning of this speech, Chief Seattle expresses his concern over environmental degradation and its possible impact upon human civilization if we do not take immediate measures. According to Chief Seattle, nature has been a great sympathizer for his native people for a long time now. Nature has given them everything they need to live on this earth, means nature has given the human beings everything what we need to live on this earth. What Chief Seattle fears, he fears that though this condition seems to be eternal and changeless, it may ultimately change. And human civilization may face great trouble in future if we as human beings don't respect environmental values. We can see what is the condition of environment nowadays. And this has been declared and given, this thing has been taken into consideration 200 years back. So that's why this Chief Seattle speech is considered to be the most esteemed part. Now coming back to the chapter, in the first paragraph, the speaker assures his reliability by comparing his words to the stars that never change. So he says that he will not change his promise in response to the government's proposal, the white government's proposal of a land treaty with the native Red Americans or native Red Indians. He says that in this speech, what is explained that the white chief or the governor had arrived with the proposal and the message of friendship from the big chief, the president, that is George Washington. So in response to that, Seattle says the statement ironically that it is a kind of US president to it is so kind of the US president and the US community to offer the natives Red Indians their goodwill and friendship. Why he said this statement in an ironical manner? Because he knows that the government has no need of the natives' friendship in return. Then in the same paragraph, Seattle also speaks of the miserable condition of his people. He remembers that once his tribe had filled the entire country or that entire Seattle's land, but now there are only few people left in this tribe. So they are, this Red Indian tribe or this Native American are on the verge of an extinction. So actually, they don't need the vast land anymore. And for this vanishing Red Indians, Chief Seattle mainly accuses the white people's act of forcing their way into the native lands. Means Chief Seattle is saying that we don't want to give this land. We are also not in need of this land because we are in less numbers. We are ready to give you, but what you are doing, you are this saying is centuries old, that the white people are attacking the Red Indian or the native people. So the anything which is being given or taken on the act of violence is not acceptable. So here Seattle says that the white people regard themselves as superior and supreme and do not respect the tribal people's land rights and cultural values. Well, in the second paragraph of the speech, Seattle criticizes the reckless manners of the young man of his own tribe. He explains that, or he says according to him, the youths should be more sensible and responsible. But because of the repulsive or because of the hatred thing of the white people towards the Red Indians, these youngsters become impulsive. They get angry and they try to attack the white people. But as they are less in numbers, they can't do anything to the white people. So what Chief Seattle is saying, he is saying to his youth generation or to his young generation, to his young tribal people, to be calm and to be responsible, because this youth's parents and grandparents pray for their safety, and they are waiting for them back at their homes. Then in the next paragraph, Seattle says that the president has offered the Seattle's tribe to protect their native women, children, and the old men from the attacks of their old outside enemies like the Heathers and the Shimshians. Chief Seattle has mentioned these two enemies as the oldest enemies, who are from the west side of the land. And this particular white chief, Washington George, has offered this native to protect them from these enemies, to protect the children, the women, and the men, the old men, from these enemies. This white people will only save or protect the children and the women and the men only if this native Red Indians will agree to the land treaty, which is being proposed by white people. Now, in this case, the president would really be their protector. The president, George Washington, would really be their protector. Whose protector? The native Red Indians' protector. He stated that this white chief has become their father. But Chief Seattle also doubts if that will be ever possible. Then, according to Seattle, there are so many cultural differences. Why Chief Seattle is doubting how can the white man or the white chief can be the protector of this tribe? So he states many cultural differences between the white Americans and the native Red Indians, that a union or mutual understanding between the two looks very unlikely. After all, they are two distinct races with separate origins and separate destinies. Even they have their separate gods. Then the Chief Seattle also explained that the white people have received all the love and care of their god, but this tribal people or this Red Indians have been deprived of the love, guidance, and protection of God. And finally, these Red Indians come to their hopeless existence. And in the same paragraph, he also explains that the native Red people of America live closer to nature than the white people. These native Red people love the beautiful aspects of nature and understand the importance of maintaining this nature. Seattle says that to the tribal people, the ashes of their ancestors are sacred. And this tribal people or this Red Indian visit their resting ground to show their respect for those ancestors, those who have died. But Seattle also says on the other hand, or he complains on the other hand, that the white settlers or the white people have no feelings for their ancestors. They wander far from their graves without any regret. So again, the white people don't seem to love this world anymore after they die. They never visit their people and places again. But the tribal people never forget this beautiful world that gave them being and continue to visit their loved ones to guide, console, and comfort them. So these are the cultural differences that has been stated by Chief Seattle. He has explained about how the Red Indian respect and visit the graves of their ancestors, and how the white people or the white settlers do not visit their ancestors' grave after they die. They forget their ancestors, but it is not like with the Red Indian people, because they respect their culture, they respect their own religion, and they respect their own ancestors. Then, in another paragraph, Seattle even says that the white people's religion, that is Christianity, is written upon stones so that people never forget it. It is not felt by heart. Their religion is somewhat artificial and mechanical, as they have no respect for the environment and for their ancestors. But he explains on the other hand that the native people religion is the traditions of his ancestors, the dreams of their old man. And which is why this native people or this red Indian cannot forget their ancestors or cannot forget the livelihood which they have got from their own land. And therefore they have this huge respect for this land. Well, while giving the speech, the chief also prepares his people for their impending doom by saying, his people means he also prepare his red Indian or his native tribe for their impending doom by saying that no one will be spared from the hands of time, death and decay. Chief Seattle also added that death is a common destiny and death will also be taste by white man. It means that the white man too cannot defy the death. After giving this ironical statement, Seattle also says that he may still agree to the government's proposal if his natives are allowed to visit the resting grounds of their ancestors. It means he is saying that if these white settlers are taking away our land from us, so this Chief Seattle is requesting, or he is putting up the proposal in front of them, that if you will allow my people or my tribe to visit their ancestors' grave or this ancestors' land, only then he will agree to give this land in the hands of white settlers. Well, the most important reason to give up by Chief Seattle this land was only that there should not be any war between these two communities. Chief Seattle wants peace and kindness between these two communities, the white Americans and the red Indians. So in the ending of the speech, Chief Seattle wants the president to be just and deal kindly with his tribe or with his people. Chief Seattle believes and explains to the white settlers that death is just a change of worlds. He is explaining them that even my tribe will die, even no one will be there to survive on this land. But this world will change, or it is considered, the death is considered as the change of worlds, but the spirits will always be there. The spirits of the natives will still be there after their death. And if the white settlers will try to hurt the red Indians badly, so these spirits will take revenge from the white settlers. So this was his religious belief and his cultural belief to take the revenge. Or in this particular line, we understood that Chief Seattle believes in karma thing. Means if you will do good to someone, the good will be returned to you. But if you will do bad to someone, then the bad will come onto you also. So we learned that the speech was given for the following reason. Let us recapitulate those points. Point number one, Seattle delivered speech in Washington in 1854. He thanked the white chief for his greetings and friendship. Then he accepted the white chief's proposition and says that it was just, without any harm. Then he speaks about the ecological and Native Americans' land rights. Then he also appeals to the white people to be kind and just to the natives. He wants the assurance of protection of his people by the white settlers. Then in the end, he offers greetings and friendship to the white people. Well, students, I request you to read this text thoroughly for better understanding. And don't forget to solve the passage question-wise. Don't forget to solve the passage-wise questions to get in-depth knowledge of this chapter. Thank you.